Well, in chapter 16, we were reintroduced to the city of Babylon. And in fact, the book of Revelation, the revelation of Jesus Christ, speaks more about the city of Babylon and what it comes to represent than any other text in the Bible. But it is mentioned many times in the Old Testament, and only one other time in the New Testament outside of the book of Revelation, and that's in the book of Acts. But beyond that also, we've come to understand that the city of Babylon is actually a city. It's a city that exists today. And I think you know that. During the era of Saddam Hussein, he was quickly rebuilding outside of Baghdad the ancient city of Babylon because he was hoping it would become kind of like a Middle East Disneyland. And people would come and they would see the ancient city of Babylon, hopefully in the splendor that once described the city as one of the seven wonders of the world, the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, because the Euphrates, a great river, spoken of as a great river in chapter 16, flowed right through the city of Babylon and provided springs and fountains and all kinds of things to really the Hanging Gardens of Babylon were astonishing to those that wrote history in those days, that could, to the best of their ability, either draw something or describe that city in a way that really astounded the people of those eras. Well, that was Saddam's idea. It never came to pass. He did have the great Ishtar Gate of Babylon rebuilt, and it was the Ishtar Gate was once built with bricks of gold. Well, he had it built with bricks of adobe, but painted gold. Because, of course, he doesn't want someone else, you know, chipping their, you know, Juan Consale Consafos, you know, that kind of thing on there. Babylon has fallen, we're told, in Revelation 16. And Babylon is now about to be described in chapter 17 as an economic system that has tremendous immorality steeped within it. It's described also as a religious system that comes to an end in chapter 18 of Revelation. And then finally, the judgment of those who preside in Babylon, Lucifer, of course, the Antichrist, otherwise referred to as the beast, and the false prophet, are in chapter 19 finally judged by the Lord God of all heaven and earth. And we discover, and it's a wonderful thing to discover, once again, we saw this in one verse in chapter 16, we see it in one verse of chapter 17, that Jesus wins. Amen. He does win. So if you've chosen Jesus, you've chosen the right team. You truly have. Babylon is a real city. It's a real city today, but it's going to become a much greater city. And you might wonder why. Because out in the barren wilderness of the Mideastern desert is something that now is no longer on the banks of the Euphrates. Now is just pretty much a desolate city of dust and pelicans. They used to be called in the Old Testament, really vultures and unclean birds. It's a city that lacks the beauty that Nebuchadnezzar had, but still has somehow inherent in its description, in its design, a great spiritual power. We do know that after the fall of Babylon, first of all, with the Medes and the Persians in Daniel's day, and then with the fall of Babylon to Alexander the Great in the Grecian era, it fell to nothing later on and became a desolate city that nobody really visited. It's really only in modern terms that the city began to be rebuilt. The ancient city where Nimrod built a tower to reach even into the realm of God, because Nimrod believed that he could sit on a throne above our Father in heaven. And we know that out of that came the confusion of the nations in different languages, as 70 different nations, 70 different language systems instantly came upon the people, and they were confused, and they dispersed to four corners of the earth in those language systems. Really, the world is still now steeped in confusion, mostly because everyone's concerned about eventual nuclear annihilation. I personally believe that's never going to happen. I personally believe that the only war that the world may describe as World War III, we were introduced to in Revelation chapter 16, when the nations of the world, deceived by these spirits that come out of the false prophet's mouth that look like frogs, influenced the kings and the nations of the earth to come in unity, a 200 million man army against the city of Jerusalem. And in that day, Zechariah 14 tells us, when the city is being ravaged, when it's being leveled, when even the women of Jerusalem are being raped and pillaged, that Jesus himself, Tzavarot, the captain of the armies of heaven, the commander-in-chief of the entire angelic host, will descend, but not with just them. Jesus said, I could call unto my aid. He said to Peter in Gethsemane, I could call to my aid a legion of angels at this very moment. We don't know how many angels stand prepared with Jesus to descend upon the earth in that day when World War III, in my terms, begins to spill upon the city of Jerusalem. We found out in chapter 16 of Revelation that a great earthquake is going to occur in that moment that will split the Mount of Olives in two, and Jesus descends, and the armies, you and I, the saints of God, will enter into the city of Jerusalem and set up an eternal kingdom that will last for 1,000 years first, the millennial reign of Christ, where you, in an imperishable, incorruptible body, will reign with Jesus for those 1,000 years, incapable of sinning, incapable of doing nothing but worshiping him, as Jesus said in John chapter 4 to the woman at the well, there is a day coming, and now is, when you, the saints of God, will worship him in spirit and in truth. And I long for that day. I long for that day when we will worship him with every fiber of our being. And I believe there is power in worship. I truly do believe that. I believe that when our congregation joins in a unified accord with the Lord God and really singing with the angels before the throne of God, the saints in heaven are gathered there as well, singing praises to the glory of God, that things happen on earth. There are so many testimonies of people being healed during worship, because it's at that point that their minds, their hearts, their souls, their spirits really connect with the throne of God. The psalmist told us that he is enthroned upon the praises of Israel. He is enthroned upon your praises. He loves the sacrifice of praise that you bring, even if it's just a joyful noise. Amen. So here in Revelation 17, we're about to discover the inward spirit or soul of this religious system that has now been perpetrated upon the earth by the Antichrist, who in chapter 13, who has declared himself as the living God in the world's midst. And the false prophet has proven through signs and wonders that even the heavens respond with fire that comes down upon the altar in the rebuilt temple in Jerusalem at the dictation of the Antichrist, that he only could be God. And of course, at that point, a mark is declared upon all those that live on the earth in those days, that you must take the mark of his worship, declaring that you are aligned. And by the way, that means an alignment politically, economically, and religiously with the Antichrist. Do you believe that there is a politic today that is bringing people to a level of idiocy that has never been known on this earth before. It will be far surpassed by the idiocy of the politic at Revelation 13, when wise people, otherwise intelligent people, will take a mark upon their bodies in worship of someone whom they know really deeply within their heart is not who he says that he is. But he is a pervasive liar. He is the son of perdition. Jesus referred to Lucifer as the father of all lies. He is able to deceive, Jesus says in Matthew 24, if possible, even the elect of God, which means, dear friends, those that are living in the time of the tribulation will be intrigued, will be tempted by the lie of the Antichrist being the returned Savior. We've heard of Babylon, we've heard of the nations in chapter 16 of Revelation, all coming together in one purposed mindset: destroy the people of Israel, destroy the capital of Israel, destroy the temple that has been rebuilt in Jerusalem. And if we destroy the people of God, then we have destroyed the God of the people as well. That's been the mindset of Lucifer from the very beginning, even back to the days antediluvian after the flood. That, yeah, I guess the Lord kind of leveled the playing field when there was a worldwide flood. And all the people in Genesis chapter 6 who could only continuously think in terms of evil intents, even in the presence of Noah, referred to in Hebrews 11 as a preacher of righteousness, they had the opportunity to believe the truth of the God of all heaven and earth, but they chose the lie. And now Nimrod comes. He is a great-grandson of Noah. And he believes within his heart that he can institute a system where people will finally rid themselves of this horrible God that must surely hate them. We have a new God, and he's right in front of us. And his wife, Semiramis, and his son, Tammuz, are in fact the God that came in flesh, Tammuz, like we all were told would come. Oh, how the devil has perpetrated lies over human history, where men have believed the lie and God had to step in and confuse the nations, had to flood the earth. But there's one truth that we find in all of these events, these catastrophic events, that God always saves his beloved. Eight people survived the flood. Why? Because God loved them and set them aside in an ark to preserve them till the flood was over. God loved the boys that were friends of Daniel when they were sent into a fiery furnace and found Jesus waiting for them there. Three men. God loves you. And oh, how it will be one day when the scrolls of our own personal history are unfolded and we see event after event that have been stamped over the top of the blood of Jesus. Grace, grace, mercy, grace, mercy, grace, mercy, grace. And the Father will look and see our names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And the two prevailing truths of our eternity will be the enduring and everlasting quality of God's mercy, and the profound gift of grace that he has given us in that Jesus gave his life to pay our ransom. Here in Revelation chapter 17, Babylon is full of themselves at this point. And John is taken in verse 1. Will you notice that with me in Revelation 17, verse 1? And one of the seven angels who in chapter 16 were pouring out the seven bowls of God's wrath here, presumably in the last couple weeks of the 7 years of tribulation, one of the angels who had the seven bowls came and spoke with me, John, and said, "Come, John, I will show you the judgment of the great prostitute who is seated on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth," verse 2 of chapter 17, committed sexual immorality, and those who live in the earth, on the earth, became drunk with the wine of her sexual immorality. It seems as though the drunkenness of the earth acting in an unnatural way are, by anyone else's terms, perhaps those, the great cloud of witness in heaven from Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, are looking upon the earth and they are watching people who formerly had a sense of propriety acting in a drunken manner as they worship this Antichrist, as they follow the false prophet and do things by being branded on their right hand or on their forehead with a brand of worship that will indelibly, eternally mark them as not so much in favor of the Antichrist, but more so eternally, absolutely out of the favor of the living God, because it cannot be removed. And Revelation 14 told us that those with the mark of the beast will be burned in hell forever and ever and ever. And that's hard to fathom. First of all, eternity is hard for us as human beings because we're very finite beings. Over and over in the Psalms, we're described as the grass that grows and then withers and blows away in the wind in one day. We can't conceive of things like eternity. This is why scientists really can't figure out what the universe is like, because they can't think in terms of mathematics describing eternity. Universe without end, universe without a curtain at some point. But then what's on the other side of that curtain in the great expanse of all that we know? And they can't describe what it is when they go to subatomic realms and discover that there are even more minuscule realms beyond that. That the very things that make up the atoms are made up of things even smaller than that. We are boggled in our minds when we consider the great expanse and the great infinitesimally small. And we think in terms of how really small that we are. And so we purport that science is our God, and that science will come up with a solution. Science will cure us. Science will help us live forever. Science, just take this supplement. Just do this exercise. Just take this mark, and you will live forever. And Babylon appears before John as this angel takes him to some vantage point where he looks down upon the earth and in a manner, in a spiritual way, sees, as it were here, this prostitute. But by the way, a great prostitute, which means she has tremendous power in those days. So, of course, we have seen how the Antichrist is the purveyor, becomes the potentate of a one-world economy, a one-world politic, and also a one-world religion. And now, as we begin to look deeper into this religious system in chapter 17 and 18, we begin to discover that there is one basal foundation to this religion that the Antichrist brings, and it's the lie of sexual immorality. Because you see, the devil is interested in dividing every Christian household, every Christian marriage, every Christian family. He wants to make your family an example to every other family that Jesus makes no difference in the heart of that father who is engaged in immorality to such an extent that perhaps even as Paul wrote to the Corinthians, it is not even named among the Gentiles what is happening in your church. Oh yes, and it happens within the church. I would never as a pastor be naive enough to say, oh, it doesn't happen in this church. Au contraire. And our request among the pastors, among the elders of this church, oftentimes is that, Holy Spirit, that you would invade the hearts and minds of our congregation, and in some terms, supernaturally, that we would see Father God, the great horror of the immorality that the devil offers to us as a false similarity to the great joy of marriage and becoming one flesh. First of all, we see in verse 1 that this great prostitute, this great powerful religious system, is seated upon many waters. And we discover in verse 2 that the kings of the earth committed, and that it does speak in terms of something past tense at the point of Revelation 17. This is at the close of the 7 years of tribulation, and in those 7 years, they have committed a religious immorality with the temptations of this earth. But John is told by this angel it is a sexual immorality. And those who live on the earth have become drunk with the wine of her sexual immorality. So primarily, we learn in chapter 16 that it is intended to coerce, as it were, to tempt the kings of the nations with one cause to come against the city of Jerusalem, to join in this huge army to defeat the people of God, to destroy the God of the people, and finally rid the earth of these stinking Jews. And by the way, while we're doing that, as the nation of Islam says, Friday first, that's their day of worship. And then Saturday, that's the Jewish worship. And then Sunday. What are they saying? We will occupy the world on Fridays by destroying the worship of Saturdays and the worship of Sundays. You don't think you're in the crosshairs of a religious system even today that has one cause in its heart, and that's to kill the infidel. Oh, Paul, it's a peaceful religion. We're not going any further with that. Did you know that according to various reports today, that the porn industry's net worth just in America, is $97 billion? Okay? $97 billion. That means that that's not just their gross national revenue in a year. That's actually what they have in savings, okay? It's enough money to feed 4.8 billion people every single day. Every year, Hollywood releases roughly 600 movies that make $10 billion in profit. Every year, over 13,000 films worldwide make about $15 billion in profit. Now get this, this might astonish you. The porn industry makes more money than the Major League Baseball, than the NFL, and the NBA combined in a single year. Combined. You might think, at this point, well, I don't know what this has to do with me. It has a lot to do with you. Why are you talking about porn? When we look at Revelation chapter 17 and we peer into verse 2 where it says sexual immorality, that's actually one word in the Greek. It is the Greek word porneia, where we get the word porn, okay? And pornography is basically the study of porn, like geography is the study of geo, whoever he is. Here's the point I'm trying to make. We are already, as a society, as a world, prepared to be influenced in a sub-religious tone to believe the Antichrist, because he is going to provide a sense among those that worship him that sexual immorality, pornography, porn, is itself a religious expression. That the self-exercise of sexuality is the healthiest thing an adult can do. I mean, we have Chelsea Clinton saying that it is unchristian to not abort your child. We are redescribing, we are redefining everything that has to do with Christianity. I'm astonished at how the church worldwide, but let's just point to the church in America, is glibly allowing celebrities, per se, to redefine what it means to be a Christian. We have a mayor running for president who says you're unchristian if you criticize his lifestyle. That, to me, is an earmark of something even more very demonic that is coming. I think we as a people, we as adults in America, have become very used to pornographic or basal sexual immorality issues in our lives. I don't know how many of you watched the Game of Thrones, but one fellow told me that of the two episodes that he watched, he was told that every episode had nudity in it. And the world fell apart when this serial came to an end. And I don't think it's because, you know, full frontal nudity came to an end. You can find that anywhere. You could be watching that on your phone in this sanctuary using our Wi-Fi. Friends, we don't realize how invading, pervading this whole industry has become in our lives. So much so, dear friends, that our consciences are seared. Paul told Timothy that in the last days, be warned of this, consciences will be seared and not relieved by good sermons, but rather their ears will be tickled so that they live with a conscience that is seared, only to be further seared by the things that we allow to invade our households. The kings of the earth. That means even the president of the United States, at the point that we're talking about here in Revelation 17, will commit sexual immorality with this religious system based out of Babylon that will influence him to do something unique that's mentioned twice in the 17th chapter. Prime ministers, whoever they are, will come in unity, in agreement with the Antichrist, that our biggest problem on this earth, it certainly isn't sexual immorality. It's Jerusalem. That's the center of all of our woes. And once we destroy Jerusalem, we will be rid, and then we can rise in consciousness to whatever nirvana the devil has promised them. But she's a whore. She's a prostitute. She offers something that never fulfills what men think it will fulfill. She offers something that is a facsimile, but is nowhere near the real thing. In the Old Testament, we have a book named Hosea, where a man told by God he must go marry a woman by the name of Gomer. And God tells Hosea, you will marry a woman that is a prostitute, and she will have children from her johns, from those that purchase her body to have sexual immorality with her. She will have children that you will raise. And their names will be Lo Ruhama, Lo Ami. Their names will be the very declaration of God that he has run out of mercy for a people who are committed to committing sexual immorality with every pagan god that comes their way. Jeremiah refers to the nation of Israel like a donkey in heat, standing on a hill, sniffing for whoever would come her way. What a picture that is. I would say to you that I know men like that. I would say to you that the earth is ripe for the Babylon's whore, for the Antichrist to come. She is seated on many waters. We're told later in Revelation 17 that verse 15, the waters that you saw where the prostitute is seated, these are people and crowds and nations and languages. That's where she's seated. She has found power over the people by what she influences them with. Now you might say, you know, my wife might have said, or some friend of mine might have said, well, you're addicted to pornography. The picture being drawn here by the angel for John is that her sexual immorality now has rule and control over the minds and the hearts of all kinds of, note this in verse 15, peoples, crowds, nations, and languages. Peoples, crowds, nations, and languages. In other words, her influence is affecting every ethnos on earth in those days. And they're drawing these people against Jerusalem, against this stoic old age God that calls us to live lives of perfection, of righteousness. Paul in Romans chapter 7 goes to great lengths to describe what a particular sin had in such mastery over him. It brought him to that place where many of us have read those verses, and we feel as though he's speaking for us when he says, I do the very things that I hate to do. What is it about this sin that has mastery over me? And the sin in his life was covetousness. Some of you probably didn't even know that that's a sin, because that's part of your life every day. Has a mastery over him where he concludes Romans 7. He didn't write in chapters, but Romans 7 concludes with this thought, O wretched man that I am, who would deliver me from this body of death. Covetousness was bringing death into his life. And he recognized it because there was still an interest in him not to be a slave to sin, but to be a slave to righteousness. It's the great struggle every Christian man and woman deal with. The mastery of sin in their life, this desire to, in a sense, say, the devil made me do it. When in reality, we make a decision at some point that I'll allow that because I'm dealing with other big things right now, and that makes me feel good. It makes me feel good to get drunk in Elmer's because you don't know the trouble I've seen. It makes me feel good to be with this woman at a massage parlor or someplace like that because it makes me feel good in the midst of all the horrifying things that are happening in my life. And all that's really happening is your conscience is being seared over and deeper. And so those things that you enjoyed earlier are not enough to make you enjoy it anymore. So the rabbit hole gets deeper and deeper and deeper. Greg Nelson, a very dear friend of mine, Calvary Chapel chaplain at the federal prison in Lompoc, is familiar with this trickle-down situation. Okay, so in America, you know, of course, pornography is not illegal. And the amount of adults and even children engaged in pornography is just astonishing. And he says, Paul, I've seen it in the prison because I've talked with these guys that are there for long terms because they started with adult pornography. It wasn't enough. The rabbit hole got deeper. And they moved to homosexual pornography. It wasn't enough. It got deeper. They moved to child pornography, but that wasn't enough either. Because the child pornography led to acting it out with children. And making money off of sending these pictures. And the feds found me. And of course, I pleaded innocence. That's what every idiot does. When they know deep within their heart, they are deeply, deeply an addict to something they can't stop. It's a locomotive out of control. And you think, every addict thinks, I've got control over this. It doesn't have control over me. But it's that, also, it's that love-hate relationship, isn't it? Look to Revelation chapter 17, verse 16. 17, verse 16. Now, we're just expanding the sense of Revelation chapter 17, verses 1 and 2. It says in verse 15, in the waters that you saw where the prostitute is seated are peoples, crowds, nations, and language. But look at verse 16. This is the common result of people that hate the very things they do. They start hating those that they can extend or transfer their problem to. Verse 16, and the 10 horns that you saw and the beast, these will hate the prostitute and will make her desolate and naked, and they will eat her flesh and will burn her up with fire. This is not a real woman. It's a religious system that indeed has to come to an end because Lucifer must be God. He will not allow any other gods, either above him or below him. So the false religious system steeped in sexual immorality must come and end as well. And men who are addicted to pornography often will tell me, I hate it. I have this love-hate relationship. It isn't as though the devil says, go look at pornography. But he fills my life with all these other problems and distractions where I find myself alone. And the only solace I can think of is talking on the phone to some woman that tells me what I want to hear. Or watching something that I know no woman in her right mind would ever provide me, certainly not my wife. And it deals, it feeds, it relaxes the conscience to being branded with something that makes it even more difficult to ever be healed. And I want to say to you, you may not think in terms of your addiction to pornography or addiction to anything else. You have power over it. I don't believe you do. I believe it has a power over you. But there is one name under heaven by which men must be saved. And this very day, he wants to release you from the prison of an addiction you might have. Name it. Name it. Pornography. It could be pain pills. It could be marijuana. It could be the bar. It could be alcohol. It could be all manner of things that you turn to rather than turning to God. Oh, I know Lucifer. How dare you just watch pornography? How dare you speak to the God of heaven and earth? Oh my, he's angry with you. He hates you at this point. He's turned his heart and his eyes from you. Turn your heart and eyes from him. Come with me, my child. And we'll go deeper into the rabbit hole. And men get lost. Men get swallowed. And they end up losing their wives. They end up losing their business, their employment, their children. They end up with diseases. They end up with issues and lifestyles that they never saw coming when they first clicked on that site or opened that magazine. And I'm here to say to you, every one of you, I'm here to say to you that Jesus saves. And I believe that the Spirit of God wants to do something supernatural today. We've talked about the blind seeing, the deaf hearing, and the lame walking. But what about hearts being restored unto him this very moment. What about a life set free? A life relieved. Are you listening? A life relieved from the addictions that are tearing you down, pulling you down into a rabbit hole you wish, because I know you hate it. You wish because of the blood of Christ that is on you. You wish you were set free from once and for all. I'm telling you today, you can be set free from that today. If you would just confess your sin before the Lord. If you will agree with God, He is faithful and just to forgive you your sin and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. All unrighteousness. The devil can't offer that. All he offers is a deeper hole. Jesus offers you today freedom. Galatians 5, verse 1, it is for freedom that Christ has set you free. So do not go back to be chained in the sins of your old life. Peter described it as a dog that goes back to sip with a straw from his vomit over and over and over again. And it describes a life that cannot find freedom because they've swallowed the pill. They've dropped into the hole. And all they want deep within your soul, I know all that you want right now in Jesus' name is just to be released, to be set free. If that's you this morning, would you just bow your heads and close your eyes?